Hello, and welcome to the History of Rome, episode 131, The New Game in Town. Last time, we left off with the Tetrarchy in general disarray. Maxentius had revolted, Severus was dead at the hands of Maximian, Galerius had been forced to slink out of Italy, and up in the north, Constantine was just sort of lurking ominously. The only members of the Imperial Brotherhood who remained untouched by the events of the last 2 years were the retired Diocletian, who is about to get dragged back into all this, and the Eastern Caesar, Maximinus Daya, who is himself about to become quite disgruntled. At this point, it might not have been clear to all the players that the game had changed, but they were about to learn pretty quick that the Tetrarchy was no longer an end unto itself. It was now simply a means to an end. In other words, getting into the Tetrarchy was not important because it makes you part emperor. It was important because it was the only way to qualify for the championship round. And I think we all know that the prize for winning the championship round was sole control of the Roman Empire. So I hope everyone is ready to keep up with the rapid-fire horse trading, alliance hopping, and double-crossing that is about to go down in pursuit of the championship, because I can tell you one thing for sure. Constantine is. You'll recall from last week that as Maxentius was preparing Italy for the imminent invasion of Galerius, he managed to secure an alliance with Constantine that would keep the newly minted Caesar out of the fighting. I mentioned that the key to this alliance was a marriage to Maxentius's sister Fausta. But I forgot to mention the other key part of the bargain. With Severus dead, the Western Augustus slot was open, and Constantine demanded that the ex-emperor Maximian use his prestige to unilaterally promote his soon-to-be son-in-law to the position. Maxentius and his father agreed to the terms, and in the summer of 307, probably not long after Galerius's withdrawal from Italy, though I'm not sure about that, a ceremony unfolded that saw Maximian hand Constantine first his daughter in marriage, and then the title Augustus. Though Constantine's promotion was essentially self-proclaimed, there was no one around to stop him, and, unlike the last time this happened, when he ultimately accepted demotion to Caesar, this time around, and for the rest of his life, Constantine never would give up the title Augustus. For the briefest of moments, even though the western and eastern halves of the empire were at each other's throats, on either side of the divide there was relative peace. But that too was about to fall apart. In the west, it seems that Maximian had for a while now been making the rather bold assumption that now that he was back. Senior Augustus, superior in rank and prestige to Constantine and Maxentius, the whole bit. But Maxentius, finally coming into his own, had no intention of ceding any real authority to his father. As far as Maxentius was concerned, Maximian was a relic. A useful relic, but a relic nonetheless. Over the course of the winter of 307-308, Maxentius and his father Maximian resided together in Rome, and when they discovered the assumptions the other had been making, they began to feud immediately. Things came to a head in the spring when Maximian got up in front of the troops and publicly denounced his own son, going so far as to physically wrestle off Maxentius's purple cloak. But Maxentius had spread the wealth around generously, and the troops in Italy were his to a man now, and they did not take kindly to this old has-been manhandling their new, and did I mention generous, benefactor. His denunciation backfiring completely, Maximian fled the city, and with nowhere else to go, headed for Nicomedia, where he hoped, get this, that Galerius would take him in. With his father out of the way, Maxentius probably hoped things would calm down a bit. But almost as soon as the old man was gone, word came up to Rome that Domitius Alexander, the vicar of Africa, had had himself proclaimed emperor by the troops at Carthage, a proclamation that had apparently been sparked after Maxentius demanded Alexander send a son to Rome to act as a hostage. This was bad news for Maxentius, as North Africa was the source of Italy's grain supply. But for the moment, there was nothing he could do about it. He couldn't turn away from the main game with Galerius just yet. But once he was legitimated within the Tetrarchy, which is something Maxentius no doubt expected straight away, he would deal with Alexander. Back in Nicomedia, Galerius was still fuming over his forced retreat when Maximian suddenly appeared on his doorstep. It is kind of surprising that the Eastern Augustus did not just have the old man executed straight away for killing his Western counterpart, but Galerius checked his wrath and instead granted Maximian asylum. At this point, it is likely that Galerius knew what he wanted his next move in the game to be and realized that Maximian could be useful. Because the next move Galerius wanted to make was convince Diocletian to come out of retirement and help him resettle the political order. Galerius may not have been able to impose his own will on his new colleagues, but he had always had a knack for getting his way with Diocletian. And Diocletian was the only man in the empire who the other tetrarchs would actually listen to. So, get Diocletian to ratify Galerius's will, and voila, a new order of things. With Maximian in hand, Galerius could now bill the meeting not as a desperate plea for Diocletian's gravitas, but instead as a summit of the original tetrarchs, minus the late Constantius, of course, to reconsider the organization of the successor tetrarchy, which was, at present, a bloody mess. Diocletian, 3 years into his retirement, finally agreed to the meeting, and in November 308, traveled from his palace in modern Croatia to one of the military cities along the Danube River to meet with Galerius and Maximian. When the three emperors were once again in the same room, Maximian wasted no time begging Diocletian to come out of retirement so they could once again be the senior Augusti together. But Diocletian had no interest at all in returning to power, and allegedly told Maximian that if his old friend were to come see the magnificent cabbages he was now growing, that he too would turn his back on the pursuit of worldly power. It was agreed then that Diocletian would stay retired, and that Maximian, look at me, Maximian, you are going to stay retired too. No more hopping down drunkenly from the stands to steal the ball from the kids. You got it? Galerius had to breathe a sigh of relief at Diocletian's response, as Diocletian coming out of retirement was the one scenario that would muck up his plan, which could now proceed as follows. Galerius would stay Augustus of the East, with Maximinus Dia as his Caesar. Constantine would be demoted back down to Caesar, despite his self-proclaimed promotion to Augustus. Instead, a newcomer, and of course, old friend of Galerius's, Gaius Valerius Licinianus Licinius, would be vaulted directly into the role of Augustus of the West. Maxentius holding Rome and Alexander holding Carthage would both be declared illegal usurpers. The bargain struck, and Diocletian returned to his happy retirement, Maximian to his unhappy retirement, and Galerius to his role as senior Augustus of a newly minted tetrarchy. Himself, Licinius, Maximinus Dia, and Constantine. It had Diocletian's seal of approval. What could possibly go wrong? To say that this was a pretty crappy reorganization of the tetrarchy is a bit of an understatement. As soon as the other principals were informed of the little committee's decision, there were at least three men wielding large armies who were instantly ticked off. Maxentius, because he had been snubbed yet again, Constantine, because they were trying to bust him back to Caesar, and Maximinus Dia, because he was still just a Caesar, while Licinius, the noob of the bunch, suddenly outranked him. How Galerius, who was clearly the driving force behind this realignment, thought that this quote-unquote compromise was going to work is a mystery to everyone. But There it was. Before I move on, I should probably do the thing where I give you a little thumbnail sketch of Licinius's pre-imperial life, especially since the newest member of the Tetrarchy will also prove to be one of its longest-serving members. And in the end, the final match of the championship round will be fought between him and Constantine. The new Augustus, like every other emperor of his age, was born to peasant stock, Dacian peasant stock to be exact, in the mid-260s AD, and he was raised in the rough border province of Moesia. Being about the same age and being from about the same place, Licinius and Galerius had apparently hooked up with each other at a young age and become fast friends. When Galerius's imperial star rose, Licinius rose with him, and he served alongside his old friend during the wars in Persia in the late 290s AD. After that, he appears to have served on Galerius's staff as a highly trusted advisor. So trusted that it was Licinius who was left in charge of the Danube frontier when Galerius left for Italy to confront Maxentius. And then so trusted that when a new Augustus needed to be appointed, Galerius pushed for his old friend Licinius. When Diocletian, for whatever reason, gave his blessing, Licinius was elevated to the purple in 308, and despite the fact that his presence in the Imperial College was annoying as all get-out to everyone but Galerius, he managed to deftly maneuver around the myriad political landmines of the early 4th century, and he hung around for a surprising 16 years before finally being blown up by Constantine in 324 AD. As I just hinted, though, the settlement hashed out between Galerius, Diocletian, and Maximian ultimately created more problems than it solved. Maximinus Dia had so far been the most stable part of the Tetrarchy, but now he became embittered at having been passed over for promotion. Out in the west, Constantine simply ignored his demotion back to Caesar and instead went right on calling himself Augustus, something that caused acute embarrassment to the rest of the Tetrarchy, as there was really very little they could do to stop Constantine from calling himself whatever he wanted. Realizing that he had miscalculated a bit, Galerius attempted to soothe both of their egos by giving the two Caesars the further title Sons of Augustus, but the transparent sop was seen for what it was by both. In the east, the unmollified Maximinus Dia would choose to follow Constantine's lead instead, and began to simply assert his own promotion to Augustus by 310 AD. And in the west, well, Constantine never stopped calling himself Augustus, even for a minute. The wild card following the settlement of 308 was Maxentius, still in control of Italy and still lacking any sort of legitimacy. Licinius's first mission on behalf of the Tetrarchy was supposed to have been bring Italy and Africa back into their hands, but as Severus and Galerius had demonstrated, that was easier said than done, and the new Western Augustus never would initiate a concentrated effort to oust Maxentius from Rome. That effort, as we will see next week, will be undertaken instead by Constantine, leading to one of the most famous and most important battles in the whole long history of the world, the Battle of the Milvian Bridge. The other wild card in all this, the really, really wild card at this point, was Maximian. Pushed back into retirement, despised by Galerius and Maximinus Dia, and obviously on the outs with his own son, the only imperial court that would accept the old man was his new son-in-law, Constantine's, settled at that point in Britain. At first, Constantine was only too happy to secure for himself the further prestige of having the old Augustus around, but it did not take long for Maximian to chafe under the weight of his own impotence and cause trouble. Trouble that will lead the once noble Maximian to a most ignoble end. Things were pretty quiet for the first year or so, as Constantine continued to tour his provinces and campaign periodically against the Germans. But in 310, as Constantine began a more strenuous little war against the Franks, Maximian seized what he thought looked a lot like an opportunity, though it would turn out to be nothing of the kind. Constantine had dispatched his father-in-law to southern Gaul with a contingent of troops to keep an eye on the Alpine passes and make sure Maxentius stayed in Italy while Constantine fought the Franks. But instead of remaining on guard duty, Maximian decided, sort of out of the blue, "Hey, I think I want to be the senior Western emperor again." So he spread the word that Constantine had died in battle, and further declared that he was an Augustus again. But the world had already moved on. In a replay of his confrontation with Maxentius 2 years earlier, Maximian discovered that whatever his past exploits, a new generation of emperors now commanded the loyalty of the troops. The soldiers under his command balked at following Maximian, and instead decided to wait for independent confirmation that Constantine really was dead. When it became obvious that Constantine was really not dead, and that having heard of Maximian's little ruse, he was now marching south with all deliberate speed, Maximian attempted to bribe the troops into following him, but they weren't having it. To follow Maximian would be to die with Maximian. Of that, they had no doubt. So Maximian headed to Marseille, which was both defensible and housed some troops who still remembered their old commander fondly. But these men were by far a minority in the city. Constantine had been more or less in charge of Britain and Gaul for the last 4 years, and in that time he had made a hugely positive impact on everyone, soldier and civilian alike. He was attentive to the needs of the citizens, undertook rebuilding projects after years of neglect, promoted the arts, and was generally seen as productive, responsive, and wise beyond his years. There was no way anyone was going to abandon him for the old man Maximian. So, I'm not sure how many hours passed from the time Constantine showed up at Marseille to the time that the back door was opened for him by a loyal subject inside the city, but it seems like it was probably somewhere in the single digits. Maximian was tracked down and captured, and then hauled before an extremely irate Constantine. Constantine explained to Maximian that out of filial duty, he was not just going to kill his father-in-law, as he would any other rebel. But if Maximian were to, say, take this opportunity to save everyone future headaches by, you know, doing the right thing, that Constantine would not at all be adverse to that. At some point in July of 310, Maximian did the right thing and hanged himself. He was about 60 years old and not so very long ago had been a successful emperor for 20 years. But now, rather than dying a hero to the empire, he died instead a broken disgrace. It was a sad end. Sure, without Diocletian, Maximian was a complete disaster. But up until the very end, he did have Diocletian. And so for most of his life, he was not a complete disaster. And though he died a hated man, he would sort of get the last laugh genetically, as it would be his grandsons and his great-grandsons who would eventually come to rule the empire following the reign of Constantine. The most immediate impact of Maximian's death was that it drove a wedge between Maxentius and Constantine. Up until now, the two had coexisted more or less peacefully, and the shared link of Fausta, Maxentius's sister and Constantine's wife, helped secure the peace. But after Maximian's death, things began to get ugly. We have no way of knowing whether the story is true, but not long after Maximian hanged himself, Constantine began passing it around that his father-in-law's suicide had nothing to do with the little rebellion Maximian had cooked up, and instead had everything to do with Maximian plotting to kill Constantine, despite having been so generously allowed to live. The key plot twist of this story was that Maximian had taken Fausta into his confidence, and that she had decided to betray her father to her husband, which cannot have gone over too well with her brother, even if he and his father were estranged. Constantine then went further and announced that Maximian's memory was henceforth damned. Throughout his provinces, provinces that had once been Maximian's, Constantine tore down statues and defaced monuments, crossing out any reference to or mention of the old Augustus. It appears that this was then picked up by the Eastern Tetrarchs, neither of whom liked Maximian one bit. This shabby treatment of his father's memory angered Maxentius, and he began styling himself now as the dutiful son, despite the fact that he and his father had no longer even been on speaking terms. And he was thus able to add defense of father's honor to his list of reasons for continuing to stand against the Tetrarchy. But before he could exact his revenge on the Tetrarchs, who just kept poking him in the eye every chance they got, Maxentius needed to clean up his own backyard. And so, in either 310 or 311, he ordered his Praetorian prefect to lead an invasion of North Africa, crush Domitius Alexander, and unclench the usurper's stranglehold on the grain supply, a stranglehold that was undermining Maxentius's popularity in Rome. Further heightening Maxentius's sense of urgency was the rumor going around that Constantine had entered into talks with Alexander to discuss what kind of pincer move they might be able to jointly put on Italy. Whether that rumor is true or not soon became irrelevant, though, as Maxentius's prefect arrived in Carthage, steamrolled the lesser African troops, and then captured Alexander and had him put to death. With Africa back under his control, Maxentius felt that he was now fully prepared to meet whatever the Tetrarchy had to throw at him. But, before anyone had a chance to do anything, the political apple cart was once again overturned. In mid-311, after having spent the last few years peacefully resigned to the fact that he was never going to be the great puppet master that Diocletian had been, Galerius got sick. Really sick. And if you believe Eusebius, the Christian writer who took particular joy in the suffering of the great persecutor, really, really sick. Like, no matter how many baths he took, the stench of Galerius's rotting insides could be smelled throughout the city sick. As I mentioned a few episodes back, when Galerius sensed that the end was near, he decreed an end to the great persecution, admitting that for all the violent coercion of the past decade, the Christians remained as obstinate as ever. In essence, the persecution has failed spectacularly, and it is time to admit defeat. But Galerius would fail even in his attempt to end the persecution in the East. After all, that was the only place it was really still going on anymore. And once he was dead, Maximinus Daya, who was not at all ready to admit defeat, revived it and set it back on its murderous path. But that was all someone else's problem now. In May of 311, whatever was killing Galerius, gangrene, bowel cancer, whatever, finally killed him. He was about 51 years old and had helped rule the empire first as a Caesar, then as an Augustus, then as the senior Augustus, for about 18 years. I think at the end of the day, we have to see Galerius mostly as a failure. He was a good lieutenant, and his triumph over the Sassanids should never be discounted. But once he wielded power in his own right, his legacy boils down to the Great Persecution, a failed policy that did a lot of damage for no measurable return, and a series of attempts to manipulate the Tetrarchy to his advantage, all of which blew up in his and the empire's face. He wasn't the worst emperor of all time, but I think you can lay the blame for a pretty good chunk of the chaos and bloodshed of the early 4th century at his doorstep. Maybe everything was destined to fall apart, but the way Galerius arranged for it to play out, all but guaranteed it. Next week, the real unraveling will begin. The four main powers left, Maximinus Daya, Constantine, Maxentius, and Licinius, will pair up to face off against the other two, Constantine with Licinius and Maximinus Daya with Maxentius. After Constantine and Licinius successfully beat down Maxentius and Maximinus, they will for a time peacefully coexist, ruling over West and East respectively, until Constantine will finally decide in 324 AD that his destiny has been put off long enough. Hello, and welcome to the History of Rome, episode 132, In This Sign. So as I'm sure you can guess by the title, we have arrived at one of the seminal events in Roman history, the moment Constantine decided that he was going to go out a conquering for Jesus. This, of course, is a massive oversimplification of a convoluted series of events, but still, it gets to the heart of the matter. Constantine is about to begin the long process of seizing control of the empire, and he will attribute his success in this endeavor to the Christian God. At least, we're pretty sure he attributed it to the Christian God. He attributed it to God, anyway. And he will use Christian symbols to give him power. Or at least, he appears to have used Christian symbols. Some of them might not have become Christian symbols until after Constantine adopted them. But at least we know that Christ himself will come to Constantine in a dream and tell him to conquer in this sign. Or was that an earlier vision he had had after staring at the sun for too long? And was that sign a cross? A chiro? A storogram? And maybe it was all made up after the fact? I'm confused. Constantine was a complicated man living in complicated times. Did you really think his relationship with Christianity was going to be simple? But before we get into all that, there is one last little bit of business we should dispense with. Conceptually, it should have probably come at the end of last week's episode, but there wasn't really time to get into it all, so here we are. Because before we can get into the age of Constantine, we need to finally close the door on the age of Diocletian. And that means killing off everyone's favorite senior Augustus. In December of 311, now 6 years removed from power, and what must have felt like a lifetime removed from his dream of a perpetually stable tetrarchy, Diocletian finally died in his palace on the eastern Adriatic coast. Despite his happy talk about how much fun retired life was, you get the feeling that by the end, Diocletian was more than ready to die. His last few months were spent in impotent agony as he found himself unable to ensure the safety of his wife and daughter, who had wound up de facto prisoners in the court of Maximinus Daia following the death of Galerius in May. Maximinus wanted to marry the widow of Galerius, but she had refused and was now at the angry mercy of the emperor she had just scorned. Diocletian tried to intervene on her behalf, but was completely ignored. Like his now-dead friend Maximian, Diocletian was discovering that the world had moved on without him. I don't think it is out of line to wonder whether the dejected ex-emperor, unable to endure any more disappointments, simply committed suicide, again, like his old friend Maximian. However it happened, he was 66 years old and had once been the senior Augustus for 20 years. The legacy of Diocletian is hard to figure. In terms of the quality of his administration, he ranks right up there with the best of the best. Augustus, Vespasian, the five good emperors. And in terms of his impact on the evolution of the empire, his only equal at this point seems to be the divine Augustus himself. Throw in the fact that he inherited a pile of smoldering rubble and turned it into a working empire again, and he is easily one of the two or three best emperors of all time. But there is no getting around the fact that he appears to have been exhausted at the end. Exhausted to the point that he made some very poor decisions that had disastrous consequences for the empire. The Great Persecution was ill-advised, to say the least. And his replacement candidates for the Tetrarchy, first Maximinus Daya and Severus, and then Licinius, all threw the balance of power so out of whack that civil war became all but inevitable. It would be easy to blame all of this on Galerius, and a lot of it does appear to have been Galerius's fault. But Diocletian's inability to have more foresight when it came to picking the men who would succeed him is a great big black mark on his record. It stains his legacy, just as Commodus stains Marcus Aurelius's and Caracalla stains Septimius Severus's. In Diocletian's defense, it might be the case that no matter who he elevated into the Tetrarchy, that civil war would have ensued. Four men with equal armies ruling separate corners of the empire? Eventually, that turns on itself, right? But that opens up the question of whether the whole system was flawed from the start. And you can't blame that on Galerius. That was Diocletian, all by himself. I think at the end of the day, Diocletian was a victim of his own success. He was so good, so personally magnetic, wielding such, dare I say, divine gravitas, that it would have been almost impossible to make accurate assumptions about what would happen when he was removed from the equation. The Tetrarchy had worked great for 20 years, and the problems it had been designed to solve were, for that period, solved. So why couldn't things go on like that forever? Oh yeah, because Diocletian is the only one good enough, smart enough, and doggone it liked enough to hold it all together. Diocletian's lasting failure, then, is that no one else lived up to his standards. Something else he shares in common with the divine Augustus, and something I think we ought not hold against him too much. He was a great emperor who ruled effectively through very difficult times, and he should be remembered as such. But his time has now passed, and for the rest of this episode, I want to focus on the epoch-shifting transformation of the man who was destined to shut the door on the age of Diocletian and usher in his own age, the age of Constantine. Thus far, Constantine has played a careful game, satisfied with incremental political advances, while avoiding any overreaching high-risk plays. Since he succeeded his father back in 306, he appears to have been focused mostly on securing his own legitimacy, establishing a rock-solid power base in Britain, Gaul, and Spain, and avoiding open confrontation with any of his brother emperors. But we are about to see a very different side of Constantine, that of a daring and audacious general who is convinced that God has made him invincible. Now, I don't think Constantine's shift from caution to aggression represents any sort of shift in his personality, but instead represents a shift in the circumstances. As long as Diocletian and Maximian and Galerius were around, Constantine was content to lay low and bide his time. But once that elder generation had been cleared out, there was nothing left to check Constantine's ambitions. After Diocletian died, Constantine appears to have looked into his own heart, then sized up the competition, and then decided that the time had come for caution to give way to daring, because, after all, fortune favors the bold. What I mean to say, then, is that I don't think Constantine's ends ever changed. I think he wanted the whole empire to be his from the very beginning, but he can and did tinker around with the means he used to achieve that end all the time. He used a Fabian-esque strategy for the first few years, because that seemed to be what the times called for. But when those times changed, he was more than ready to follow the aggressive lead of a Scipio Africanus. But as much as his military posture is about to change from prudent holding pattern to reckless dive bombing, it was Constantine's political posture that marked the most important change of all. And by political posture, I of course mean religious posture. As a young man, it appears that Constantine had no problem with the Jupiter-Hercules religious ideology of the Tetrarchy, nor with the pagan polytheism of the wider Roman Empire. He counted, for example, first Mars and then Apollo as his patron deities. But as he grew older, and perhaps as a result of finally joining up with his father, Constantine seems to have drifted into a vague monotheism. He was still respectful of the old pantheon and continued to make all the necessary sacrifices, but specifically, he was now moving in the direction of Aurelian's old cult of Sol Invictus. When he became Caesar in 306, the propaganda emanating from Constantine's court continued this march towards an almost exclusive solar monotheism. This religious evolution seems to have rested on two main pillars, intertwined and not at all mutually exclusive. One pillar was Constantine's pious, dare I say superstitious, desire to identify the correct god and then worship it. The other pillar was Constantine's crass desire to identify the surest path to absolute power and then exploit it. There's been a great deal of ink spilled over the question of whether Constantine was really a Christian or whether he was just cynically exploiting the religion to his own advantage, and I've got to say, I think it's a bit of both. Throughout his life, Constantine was something of a seeker. But rather than seeking in the hippie sense of trying to find universal truth or everlasting peace or whatever, Constantine was seeking power. Tangible, worldly power. And I think he genuinely believed that not only did God play a role in how events on Earth unfolded, but that getting on the right side of the right God was the ticket to the top. In other words, Constantine was not some cynical atheist like Cicero, who thought religion merely a necessary fiction. Necessary, yes, but a fiction nonetheless. Constantine was a true believer. But that being said, Constantine was also well aware that if he was going to topple the Tetrarchy and rule in his own right, that he was going to have to cobble together some kind of independent coalition. That is, gather together all those people who were unhappy with the existing order and get them working for him. And one of the largest and fastest growing groups who was unhappy with the existing order were the religious monotheists, and in particular, the Christians, who were mighty peeved about the Great Persecution. Constantine, then, was only too happy to promote his own personal monotheism, signal his sympathy for the Christians, and tell anyone who would listen that he was only doing what God was bidding. So, I'm not going to worry too much about how sincere Constantine was in his beliefs, because I reckon when it comes to analyzing the underlying ideologies of his reign, that we should probably just look to the spot where his religious zeal intersects with his political savvy, and just leave it at that. Which, of course, brings us to one of the most important pieces of that underlying ideology. Namely, that in the lead-up to his war with Maxentius, that Constantine experienced visions and dreams that promised him victory as long as he gave himself over to the Christian God. That's what Constantine said later, anyway, after he had become sole ruler of the empire and wanted to establish a nice, smooth origin story for himself. Unfortunately for us, though, Constantine's origin story is anything but smooth. Even something as simple as which sign Constantine used to conquer by is going to take a bit of untangling, but hey, that's why we're all here. If you were asked the man or woman in the street to tell you the story of Constantine's conversion to Christianity, conversion in the loose sense here rather than the technical sense, they would probably stare at you blankly. But once you found someone who had any idea what you were talking about, they would probably tell you a story that goes something like this. On the day before some great battle, Constantine saw a vision of the cross in the sky and was told by Christ to conquer using this sign. Then he painted the cross on the shields of all his men and proceeded to win the battle handily, establishing Christianity as the official religion of the Roman Empire forever. Now, this is not the worst case of mashed-up history you'll ever hear, but it is definitely a case of mashed-up history. And of course, I tack that last bit on Just to remind everyone that as much as Christianity was favored and promoted by Constantine, it did not actually become the official religion of the Roman Empire until the reign of Theodosius, some 50 years after Constantine's death. This commonly told version of the story is derived from two main sources, both of which provide some of the details, but neither of which tell the story exactly the same way, nor do they tell the story the same way that people usually tell it today. First, we have Lactantius, a contemporary Christian writer who briefly mentions that on the night before the Battle of the Milvian Bridge, that, quote, Constantine was directed in a dream to cause the heavenly sign to be delineated on the shields of his soldiers, and so to proceed to battle. He did as he had been commanded, and he marked on their shields the letter X, with a perpendicular line drawn through it and turned round thus at the top, being the cipher of Christ. Having this sign, his troops stood to arms. Now, one thing we should note right away is that the sign by which Constantine conquered was not the simple cross that we are all familiar with today. Instead, he is describing the Chi Rho, a symbol comprised of the Greek letters Chi and Rho, the first two letters of Christ's name. And to help keep this stuff straight, a picture of the Chi Rho is helpfully posted at thehistoryofrome.typepad.com. Now what's interesting about this is that though the Chi Rho would eventually become associated exclusively with Christianity, this appears to be the first time it was ever used as a Christian symbol. Before Constantine, it was used mostly by scholars to mark passages they wanted to return to, because Chi and Rho were also the first letters of a Greek word for good. So it was already a sort of well-known good luck symbol in the ancient world, before Constantine was allegedly commanded to paint it on the shield of his soldiers, which, I think, hints at how much Constantine's political savvy was also coming into play. The dual meaning of Chi Rho meant that Christians could see what they wanted to see, and pagans could see what they wanted to see, without stepping on each other's toes. And this was very helpful when it came to building a broad coalition of forces. The other version of the story we have comes from Eusebius, who would later drift in and out of Constantine's court, and in addition to many other scholarly works, including a very famous history of the early church, he would write the emperor's first official biography. In that biography, Eusebius relays a version of events that he swears came straight from Constantine himself. At some point prior to the battle, the future emperor was marching along with his men when he suddenly saw a vision above the sun, a cross of light with the Greek words, "In this sign conquer," written alongside. By the time Constantine was relaying the story to Eusebius, the emperor added the further embellishment that he was not the only one to see it, and that in fact his whole army shared in the vision. Eusebius then continues with his version of the Lactantius story, that on the night before the battle, Constantine was visited by Christ himself, who told Constantine to use the Chi Rho as a symbol of power against his enemies. This prompted Constantine to create the Labarum, a military standard that featured the Chi Rho atop a more traditional cross, of which there is also a picture at thehistoryofrome.typepad.com. So, what are we to make of all this? Just to dispense with, modern scholars put almost no stock in the vision in the sky story, and certainly no stock in the bit about the whole army sharing the vision. Instead, they mark it down as a later bit of useful fiction, probably designed to continue the conflation between the old god Sol Invictus and Constantine's new powerful Christian god. The dream on the night before the battle, on the other hand, is at least plausible. Men do dream powerful dreams, after all. But what Constantine did with the information, Jesus or whoever had given him, is still unknown. Did he really paint a Chi Rho on the shields of all 40,000 of his men? This seems a bit cumbersome for the morning of a great battle. So maybe he just painted the shields of his bodyguard? Or maybe the shield painting never happened at all, and his army simply took the field behind a hastily cobbled together labarum. Or Maybe the whole business about the Cairo is an anachronism. Though the Labarum would, by Eusebius' time, be one of Constantine's most powerful symbols, there is no actual proof that it was employed as early as 312. And the fact that it appears nowhere on Constantine's triumphal arch does seem a bit odd, given the central place in the narrative it later enjoyed. Nor, for that matter, is there any proof that at this point Constantine was openly advertising a direct connection with the Christian God, which you'd think would be pretty unequivocal at this point. So I think what we're dealing with here is a case where Constantine wanted to leave himself room to maneuver as events unfolded, but then wanted to cement one particular version of the story, a very Christian version of the story, once it was all over. That's why it's difficult to make hard judgments about how and when he became a Christian, and how sincere he was, and how much he attributed his success to the Christian God at the time. We know that down the road, he definitely stated that he had been serving the Christian God all along. But at the time, Constantine used vague enough symbols and vague enough language that his meaning could be interpreted multiple ways. I am sure that Constantine's religious dissimulation was good politics at the time, but it sure makes it hard to untangle what really happened and why. Okay, now that that's all out of the way, we need to turn our attention back to worldly events in order to fully set the stage for Constantine's showdown with Maxentius, which I thought we were going to get to this week, but because of time constraints, we won't get to the actual Battle of the Milvian Bridge until next week. Counterintuitively, the first thing we need to cover is the political situation in the East. Following Galerius's death in May 311, Maximinus Daya wasted no time ensuring that his days of being passed over were over. He was likely in Antioch when word came that Galerius was dead, and right away Maximinus marched west, intent on grabbing the whole of Asia Minor before anyone else could react. The anyone else he had to worry about was Licinius, who, since his elevation to Augustus in 308, had been based in Pannonia. Licinius did indeed pack up and head east, but in the foot race to the Hellespont, he was beaten by Maximinus. The two emperors then met on a boat on that sliver of water separating Europe from Asia, and agreed to use the Hellespont as the dividing line between their respective spheres of influence. Maximinus would control the whole of the east, while Licinius would control Greece, Pannonia, and the Danube frontier. For about 12 seconds then, Maximinus and Licinius were in alliance. At about this same time back in Italy, Maxentius decided that with Galerius out of the picture, it was time to once again assert his right to power. Only this time, even more aggressively than before. To this end, he decided that if he controlled the whole Western Empire, that Licinius and Maximinus would be forced to recognize him, which meant bumping off Constantine. Embracing that whole dutiful son angle, Maxentius used Constantine's mistreatment of his father and his father's legacy as a casus belli and declared war on his brother-in-law in mid-311. That, at least, is the version of history Constantine promoted immediately following his victory over Maxentius. Whether or not this version is true, however, is an open question, and it certainly doesn't help that later in life, Constantine would change his story and promote a different version of events that has him initiating the war as a noble, and divinely inspired, of course, mission to free Rome from the evil pagan tyrant Maxentius. So, it is tough to say for sure who fired the first shot and why, but whoever did what when, in the spring of 312, Constantine and Maxentius would be at war. In preparation for the conflict, either because he had just declared war or because Maxentius had just declared war on him, Constantine reached out to Licinius to secure an alliance. This alliance, which would isolate Italy and ensure Constantine would not be jumped from behind while he dealt with Maxentius, was cemented by the engagement of Constantine's sister to Licinius, a marriage that would eventually take place in early 313 AD. When Maximinus Daya and Maxentius received word that Licinius and Constantine were now in cahoots, it did not take long for either man to recognize how much this shifted the balance of power away from them. So Maximinus Daya, now technically the longest serving of the emperors, sent envoys to Maxentius in Rome, promising political recognition and full legitimacy in exchange for a military alliance. Since this is what Maxentius had wanted all along, he readily agreed to the pact, and so the battle lines were drawn. Constantine and Licinius versus Maxentius and Maximinus Daya. Over the course of the winter 311-312, a winter, I should remind you, that saw Diocletian finally die, Constantine and his advisors mulled over what to do next. For most of Constantine's inner circle, there were two paths to victory. One, remain in Gaul and wait for Maxentius to come to them, which will leave him outnumbered, fighting in enemy territory, ill-supplied, and constantly worrying about the political situation back in Italy. Or, two, remain in Gaul and hope Maxentius stays in Italy, where, besieged from all sides and forced to raise ever more taxes and levy ever more troops to stay in power, his regime will eventually be toppled from within by angry Italians, who, Constantine's advisors had it on very good authority, had grown disenchanted with the man. Either way, the smart play, the safe play, and the winning play was to remain in Gaul, which is why Constantine announced his intention to invade Italy. Wait, what? Next week, yes, you heard me right. Constantine will invade Italy. Whether he just thought it was good strategy, or whether he really thought God was on his side and would protect him, Constantine would set off in the spring of 312, on an audacious march on Rome. He had no good reason to think he would fare any better than Severus or Galerius, who had both found Rome impenetrable. But when he arrived at the Eternal City, he would find himself the benefactor of what could be described, if you were so inclined, as a miracle. Hello, and welcome to the History of Rome, Episode 133, The Milvian Bridge. Last week, we laid the groundwork for Constantine's showdown with Maxentius, a showdown that would culminate with the epic Battle of the Milvian Bridge, a battle that has gone down as one of the most important in world history. As momentous an event as it was, though, it is important to keep in mind that, at the time, there was absolutely no indication that the battle would take on such enormous significance down the road. At the time, it was just another clash in the Tetrarchy's running civil war, a clash fought between two ambitious men who wielded a great deal of power and wanted to wield a great deal more. It was not yet seen as a monumental battle between Christianity and paganism, and Constantine's victory was not yet being painted as the inevitable victory of God over the gods. Constantine's victory over Maxentius was a big deal. After all, it left him in sole control of the Western Empire. But it was a big deal only in the limited sense of how much it strengthened his position relative to Maximinus Daya and Licinius, his partners in slash rivals for power. Had things turned out differently, that is, had Constantine not eventually wound up on top, the fact that prior to some ultimately irrelevant battle he had his men paint some random symbol on their shields would not have mattered at all. But he did wind up on top, and so it does matter. And because down the road the Battle of the Milvian Bridge will be pointed to as the moment when the Christianization of the Western world really got going, it matters a lot. Nowhere was the non-inevitability of Constantine's victory more acutely felt than in his inner circle. Having determined that the best way to handle Maxentius would be to remain in Gaul, there was much consternation in the spring of 312 as they found themselves instead organizing the invasion of Italy. Nothing, they felt, could have played more into Maxentius' hands. Constantine's forces would be numerically inferior, they would be fighting on Maxentius' turf, and perhaps most importantly of all, they would be giving Maxentius a chance to win before his domestic political troubles had a chance to bring him down without Constantine needing to lift a finger. Because word on the street was that the Romans were not as hot on Maxentius as they had once been. The masses had supported him initially because they basically supported anyone who brought the bread and circuses, but years of estrangement from Africa and the consequent disruption of the bread part of that equation had more or less soured the mob on their emperor. The aristocracy had backed him initially because they believed that he would help restore their ancient privileges, but instead, he was taxing them harder and faster than the Tetrarchy had. In Maxentius's defense, he had an army to pay for, and a government to pay for, and infrastructure projects to pay for, and unlike emperors past, he wasn't able to offset these costs with provincial taxes. But still, after 5 years in power, he had pretty much alienated all of his subjects. Now, it should be obvious why he had an army to pay for and a government to pay for, but what of these infrastructure projects of which you speak? If heavy taxation was threatening his political position, why indulge in public works projects? The answer is that Maxentius thought that he was actually shoring up his political position rather than undermining it. It had been a long time since an emperor, or whatever Maxentius was, had taken a keen interest in the architectural well-being of the capital, and Maxentius figured that that meant he had a golden opportunity to put his own stamp on the Eternal City, provide excellent new public spaces for the population, and leave future generations remembering how great and wonderful Maxentius had been. And though that last bit had to take a detour through Constantine's co-option of all these projects following the Battle of the Milvian Bridge, Maxentius was successful in making his stamp on the Eternal City permanent, as visitors to the Forum still marvel today at the remains of the Basilica of Maxentius, one of the largest freestanding buildings the Romans ever built. But though in the long run his projects were seen as a net positive, right now they were too much drain and not enough gain, leaving many of the elites in Rome not exactly adverse to the idea of a Constantine victory. This, coupled with the lingering resentment of the masses who were still angry about the food shortages, left Maxentius in a precarious position politically, which is why Constantine's advisors wanted to wait and let nature take its course. But Constantine was determined to invade, possibly because he knew that God was on his side. Leaving the majority of his troops behind to keep an eye on the frontiers, Constantine marched through the Alps in the spring of 312 with a force of about 40,000 men, representing roughly one quarter of all his available troops. But, critically, less than half of the 100,000-man army Maxentius had at his disposal. So, it's a good thing God was on his side, because otherwise, Constantine's plan looked a little kooky. But God was not the only thing Constantine had on his side. His 40,000 men were highly trained veteran soldiers, mostly German, and intensely loyal to Constantine. By contrast, Maxentius' 100,000 men were mostly raw recruits, whose loyalty to Maxentius was dubious at best. So maybe Constantine wasn't resting all his hopes on the grace of God. The first Italian city Constantine hit on the east side of the Alps was a fortified town called Segusium. And though it made a show of resisting, there was very little they could do, and soon they were at Constantine's mercy. But after burning down the gate and capturing the town, Constantine demonstrated to everyone, friend and foe alike, exactly what kind of conqueror he planned to be, and he ordered his men to refrain from any plundering. This, of course, stood in stark contrast to Galerius's punitive march through Italy back in 307. Constantine was trying to win a military campaign, yes, but winning the political campaign was even more important. In the opening skirmish of the war, then, he had scored a minor victory in the former, but a huge victory in the latter, a victory that would lay the groundwork for the rest of the campaign. The first significant fighting took place a bit further east, near the modern city of Torino, where a formidable contingent of Maxentius's cavalry pounced on Constantine's marching army. But Constantine was able to successfully flank them, and Maxentius's forces were driven off. The defeated horsemen made for Torino, but the inhabitants of the city refused to open the gates to them, forcing Maxentius's men out of the region completely. Constantine then marched unchallenged to Milan, where the gates were thrown open, and he was welcomed by a cheering crowd. Yes, the military war was going fine, but the political war was going great. Constantine then remained in Milan for a bit, consolidating his position and resting his men, because though it had been pretty easy going so far, no one had any illusions that the going was going to stay this easy. The first real test came in midsummer, when Constantine advanced east to face Maxentius's main forward army, led by the capable Praetorian prefect Ruricius Pompeianus, the same man who had been dispatched to Africa to take down Domitius Alexander. Ruricius had holed up in the modern city of Verona, which was easily defensible as it was bounded on three sides by a river, and he was essentially daring Constantine to try and dislodge him. Constantine took the dare and sent a detachment of men around north of the city with orders to cross the river unnoticed and slip over the relatively under-garrisoned north wall. However, Ruricius was alerted to the maneuver and sent a force in to quash the attempt. But his much larger force was somehow defeated by Constantine's small expedition. This is about the time when God really starts to enter the equation, because Constantine is about to make a habit of winning despite being vastly outnumbered. Then again, maybe it was just a matter of the relative quality of the soldiers on each side. Then again, maybe it was just luck. Thwarted in his initial surprise attack, Constantine decided to follow up with the opposite approach. He surrounded the city completely and settled in for a good old-fashioned siege. Thinking fast, Ruricius slipped out of the city before the clampdown was complete and made his way south to collect a relief force. The idea would be to bring this force up, make Constantine break away from the siege to face them, and allow the army inside Verona to come pouring out, trapping Constantine between the two armies and hopefully destroying him. But as the relief army neared the city, Ruricius discovered that Constantine was refusing to break off the siege, and instead had sent what appeared to be only a token resistance force to halt his march. Okay, so much the better then. Now we get to trap him right against the city walls. That'll work too. And here's where God shows his hand again. Or maybe just where Constantine's soldiers show that they are just flat out better again. Or maybe more luck. Constantine's defense force met Ruricius's much larger relief army, and after a hotly contested fight, utterly routed them. Ruricius himself was killed in the battle. The soldiers left inside Verona, now leaderless and demoralized, decided there was no use resisting anymore, and opened the gates to the seemingly invincible Constantine. In short order, envoys from all the major northern Italian cities, including Aquileia and Ravenna, arrived in Constantine's camp to announce their surrender. Yes, things were going just fine for Constantine. But he still had one major obstacle to overcome, and this was the obstacle that had broken first Severus and then Galerius, Rome itself. The walls of the city had not gotten any shorter or any thinner since those two previous emperors had made their attempt, nor was the city any less garrisoned or any less provisioned. A siege seemed hopeless, and there was no way on God's green earth that Maxentius was going to come out and offer battle. Not when he could sit tight inside the city and wait for Constantine to give up. So, what exactly is the plan here? I guess march on Rome and see what happens next? Well aware that Constantine was now on his way, Maxentius ordered all the bridges spanning the Tiber demolished, which would not necessarily stop Constantine's advance, but it would slow him down. Except that Constantine was in no hurry. Knowing he was in full control of northern Italy, He marched south at a snail's pace, letting each passing day add luster to the aura of inevitability he was now bathed in. As summer gave way to fall, the residents of every city, town, and farm Constantine passed cheered him and wished him well and hailed him as emperor. With the anticipation now killing them, the citizens of Rome grew restless, and demonstrations began to break out, culminating with a pro-Constantinian chant at a set of chariot races Maxentius was overseeing. This all had the intended effect, and Maxentius began to seriously worry about his ability to hold out against a siege. The citizens had been with him when he fought Severus and Galerius, but right now, the city looked like it was ready to welcome Constantine with open arms. Plus, behind closed doors, it was well known that the city was not in fact as well supplied as it had been before, as the years of estrangement with Africa had taken their toll on the imperial stockpiles as much as they had the free grain dole. All of this led Maxentius to contemplate a course of action that no one thought he would take in a million years, because, I mean, it would take a miracle to get him out from behind the Aurelian walls. With Constantine finally parked just beyond the ruined Milvian Bridge on the north side of the Tiber in late October 312 AD, Maxentius consulted with his soothsayers to take the pulse of the gods so he could figure out what he should do. As it turned out, the morning he went to talk to them was the morning of October 28, which just so happened to be the sixth anniversary of his reign. These sorts of anniversaries were considered particularly auspicious, and the soothsayers then confirmed with other readings that the enemies of Rome would be defeated on that very day. Maxentius needed no further prompting. He ordered his army out of the gates and into the field. He was going to take the fight to Constantine and settle this once and for all. But of course, as we learned last week, on the night of October 27, Constantine had made his own supernatural connection, and now believed completely that he was fighting with the full blessing of the one true God. With the magical Cairo leading the way, either posted atop a standard or painted on the shields of his men, his army was truly invincible. That Maxentius was now suddenly and inexplicably marching out of Rome to face them? Well, is that not a miracle of God? Yes, the enemies of Rome would be defeated on that day. But the soothsayers never did say who those enemies of Rome were, now did they? So as you may have picked up already, the Battle of the Milvian Bridge is a bit of a misnomer. After all, prior to Constantine's arrival, Maxentius had ordered all the bridges across the Tiber destroyed, and that included the Milvian Bridge. So when Maxentius's army finished the short march from the Flaminian Gate to the spot on the Tiber where the bridge had stood, he had to build a pontoon bridge of rafts to get his men to the other side. So I think the battle should technically be called the Battle of a Spot near the spot where the Milvian Bridge had been, but where there was now a temporary pontoon bridge. But that doesn't really roll off the tongue, so Battle of the Milvian Bridge it is. Though Maxentius nullified his greatest advantage when he decided to come out from behind the Aurelian walls, when he took the field on the morning of October 28, he still had every reason to be confident, as by all accounts, he outnumbered Constantine something like 2-1. He arrayed his army in a long line with its back to the river, long enough that hopefully they would be able to envelop Constantine's smaller army. But not unlike the Greeks at Marathon, Constantine decided to risk going to battle with too thin a line, and extended his own to match the length of Maxentius's to prevent an easy flanking move. The two armies thus lined up, Constantine took the initiative and ordered his cavalry to attack Maxentius's horsemen. In short order, Maxentius's less able cavalry was broken up, and Constantine ordered his infantry to advance. The fight that ensued was a bitter one, but short, because it appears that Constantine simply took the field with more talented soldiers, and so Maxentius's army began to be pushed back. Here now, Maxentius's decisive blunder was revealed to all. He had lined up his army so close to the river that when they needed to fall back and regroup, they really had nowhere to go, and things quickly got out of hand. Hoping to live to fight another day, Maxentius ordered a retreat back to Rome. After all, the Aurelian walls haven't gone anywhere. I can still hold out against a siege. But the order to retreat sparked panic, as way too many men tried to cross way too rickety a pontoon bridge to get back to the safe side of the Tiber. Lactantius reports that as Maxentius himself tried to cross the river, he was pushed aside by fleeing soldiers and knocked into the Tiber, where he drowned. He was 34 years old and had been emperor, but never really been emperor, for exactly 6 years. Constantine spent the rest of the day mopping things up, but on October the 29th he entered Rome as a conquering hero. He staged an adventus, which was something like a low-grade triumph, and paraded his way through the streets to the cheers of the masses. When he arrived in the Forum, though, he pointedly did not climb up the Capitoline Hill and make a sacrifice at the Temple of Jupiter, as would have been standard operating procedure. A clear sign, at least in retrospect, that the times, they were a-changin'. But despite his now increasingly revolutionary religious posture, Constantine was not ready to upend every apple cart he could get his hands on. Not yet, anyway. So at the end of his parade, he went to the Curia to meet with the Senate and make nice. They had every reason to fear for their lives and property, but Constantine again cast himself as the merciful conqueror and announced that there would be no retribution against Maxentius' supporters. On top of that, he told them that all those ancient privileges they had been pining for would be returned to them now that he was in charge. This was all greeted with enthusiastic applause, and they proclaimed him as the greatest Augustus, in effect pronouncing him the senior member of the Tetrarchy, something that Maximinus Daya would certainly have something to say about. But Constantine did have a little bit of housekeeping to attend to. He declared Maxentius's memory to be damned, and all his laws and edicts nullified. All the inscriptions on all the buildings Maxentius had erected were scratched out and replaced by inscriptions dedicated to Constantine. This, for example, is how the Basilica of Maxentius, which wasn't yet completed, came to be known as the Basilica of Constantine. Turning to a more grisly business, Constantine ordered Maxentius's body dragged out of the Tiber and beheaded. The head was then paraded through the city as a warning to everyone of what happens to the enemies of Constantine. Then it was put in a box and sent to North Africa, so that the locals there would understand completely that Constantine was now in charge and that it was best not to mess with him. Finally, Constantine officially brought an end to the institution that had been so instrumental in shaping the course of Roman history. 300 years after being formally organized, the Praetorian Guard was abolished for good. The remaining guardsmen, that is, those who had not died fighting for Maxentius, were reassigned to posts all over the empire, and their camp, the site of so many pivotal events over the centuries, was demolished. It was nothing less than the end of an era. So as I said at the beginning, in all of this, there is nothing of the legendary triumph of Christianity over paganism that is usually associated with Constantine's victory at the Milvian Bridge. All of that would come later, after Constantine was firmly entrenched in power. For now, the theme of Constantine's victory was simply that he had freed Rome from the tyrant Maxentius. An exaggerated caricature of Maxentius was drawn up, painting him as a vile and illegal dictator. But the overt Christian themes would not be played up until later. That said, however, it cannot be denied that at this point, at a minimum, Constantine was hugely sympathetic to the Christian cause. The Edict of Milan, which we will talk about next week, for example, will be issued just months after his victory at the Milvian Bridge, showing that Constantine was not just sympathetic, but that he was ready to act on that sympathy at the first opportunity. At the other end of the spectrum, it can plausibly be claimed that at this point, Constantine was already a true believer, but one who understood that sudden proclamations of his own Christianity might do more harm to the cause than good, as it would alienate a pagan population ready to be sympathetic and tolerant, but not yet ready to convert, or, perhaps more importantly, have their emperor convert. His snubbing of the Capitoline Jupiter is telling, as is the statue he had erected in the Forum, which showed him triumphantly holding the Labarum, which was understood by Constantine to be a Christian symbol of power. These actions hint that there was something more than vague monotheism at work behind the curtain, but also that he was not yet ready to reveal his whole hand. Next week, after heading to Milan to cement the alliance between Constantine and Licinius and discuss the aforementioned Edict of Milan, we will head east to see how Maximinus Daya is handling all of this, and I can assure you he is not happy about any of it. Isolated in the east, it will be make-or-break time for the man who was supposed to be the senior member of the Imperial College, but who was no longer recognized as such by his brother emperors. Unfortunately for Maximinus, though, despite his best efforts, it will turn out to be break time, and in less than a year, what had once been rule by four will be down to rule by two, with Constantine in charge of the west and Licinius the east. I wonder how long that is going to last. Hello, and welcome to the History of Rome, episode 134, and then there were two. When Constantine defeated Maxentius in the autumn of 312 AD, the question of who would rule the Western Empire was settled for a generation, and it would not be until after the death of Constantine in 337 that it would be raised again. But in the East, the picture was still cloudy, and it would take another decade of on-again, off-again civil war to clear things up. As it stood on the morning after Constantine's triumph, there were two men vying for power in the east, Maximinus Daya and Licinius. The two rival Augusti hated each other. Maximinus thought Licinius an unworthy usurper, and Licinius thought Maximinus a brutish tyrant. It would not take long for the tense peace the two men had agreed to at the Hellespont in 311 AD to devolve into open war. Following the summit at the Hellespont, Maximinus Daya took up residence in Nicomedia, which had become the de facto capital for whoever was the senior Eastern Augustus, which Maximinus most assuredly considered himself to be. He immediately set himself to the task of consolidating his power base by issuing edicts lessening the tax burden for the citizens of Asia Minor. He already had a firm grip on the Far East, but the provinces of Anatolia were new territory for Maximinus, and he wanted to make sure everyone's first impression of him was a good one. And, indeed, it was. Everyone likes a tax break. But this initial generosity was followed up by the return of a policy that just about everyone had been glad to see retired once and for all, the Great Persecution. Maximinus was one of those few people in the empire who had been dismayed when Galerius pulled the plug on the persecution, as he was in that hardcore minority of advisors who had always wanted to push the persecution harder and further. Now that he ruled in his own right, Maximinus had no intention of letting the wish of some dead emperor get in his way, and just months after Galerius had canceled it, the Great Persecution was fired right back up. But despite the fact that he was now the unquestioned ruler of the East, Maximinus still had trouble getting the persecution back up and running to his liking. And rather than tales of mass murders and large-scale destruction of property, we instead see more isolated incidents in Maximinus' persecution. For example, the Bishop of Alexandria will be executed in November of 311, and, after being tried by the emperor personally, a church scholar named Lucian of Antioch will be killed after he refused to renounce his faith in January of 312. For the rest of his life, Maximinus maintained his bitter hatred of the Christians, and had he beaten Licinius, a pre-battle vow he made to Jupiter that we'll get to in a moment, likely would have resulted in something close to genocide. But happily for the Christians of the empire, the rest of Maximinus's life was taken up with more pressing matters, and he never was able to devote himself exclusively to their persecution, as he no doubt would have loved to do. One of those pressing matters came to his attention over the winter of 311-312, namely, that an alliance had likely been forged between Licinius and Constantine. As we discussed 2 weeks ago, this alliance spelled trouble for Maximinus Daya and Maxentius both. So Maximinus sent envoys promising to use his power as senior Augustus, self-proclaimed power of course, to recognize Maxentius's legitimacy in exchange for military support. The move towards friendship with Maxentius was necessary given the circumstances, but ultimately, in the grand scheme of things, it turned out to be little more than a footnote in the history books, because in less than a year, Maxentius would be dead and Constantine would rule the West. This would have been bad enough for Maximinus, but his problems were exacerbated by another pressing matter. The Sassanids were getting shifty again. Forced to head east to deal with the Persians, when Maximinus learned of Constantine's victory, he was bogged down in the Syrian desert. So right at the moment when he found out that his enemies were triumphant, Maximinus was as far away from being able to do anything about it as he could have possibly been. With Maximinus busy fighting the Sassanids, Constantine and Licinius felt like they had more than enough time over the winter of 312-313 to meet in person, cement their alliance, and make a plan for how they were going to deal with their brother in the east. The main upshot of their meeting was the publication of one of the more famous edicts ever issued. Constantine left Rome in January 313 and headed up to the more convenient imperial headquarters of Milan. When Licinius finally showed up in March, the first order of business was tying the families of the two Augusti together, and the marriage between Licinius and Constantine's sister Constantia was finally officiated. Now that they were one big happy family, the two Augusti got down to the business of figuring out what their alliance really meant. In the main, at least for now, it meant joining forces to dispense with the hated Maximinus Daya. They decided, or more likely Constantine decided, that the best way to simultaneously provoke Maximinus militarily while isolating him politically would be to hammer him for his hardline anti-Christian policies. To this end, they issued a joint resolution concerning the status of Christians in the empire that has become known as the Edict of Milan. The edict is famous because it essentially legalized Christianity in the Roman Empire. Over the centuries, the Christians had been alternatively tolerated or persecuted, but their religion had never been, strictly speaking, legal. When Galerius attempted to end the persecution, his deathbed edict basically just said, "Well, I give up, let's stop persecuting them," but it went no further than that. The Edict of Milan, on the other hand, firmly established not only the Christian right to worship, but it also directed provincial authorities to restore all confiscated wealth and property to the victims of the persecution. So the same officials who had so recently been kicking down doors and wrecking lives were now ordered to go back hat in hand and return to the Christians everything that had been seized. Even in the tolerant West, this was a clear break with precedent. Usually in these situations, Christians felt lucky to just not be harassed anymore. But to have everything that had been stolen restored to them by the authorities at the direction of the emperor? Well, that was new. As momentous an event as it was, though, and it was a momentous event, when the Edict of Milan was issued in March of 312, it was initially more theory than practice, especially in the East, where Maximinus's ideology of persecution continued to reign, which, moral imperatives aside, was kind of the point. Though I have no doubt that Constantine wrote the edict in part for moral reasons, he was also acting for political reasons. By issuing an edict that struck directly at one of Maximinus' core principles, Constantine and Licinius were painting Maximinus into a corner. Either he could comply with the edict, signaling at least tacitly that he was indeed still the junior member of the Tetrarchy and could be pushed around, or he could refuse to comply, which would give his Western brothers a convenient justification for war. There is little doubt that Constantine and Licinius fully expected the latter. And indeed, Maximinus would give them what they wanted, but probably sooner than they would have hoped. Maximinus, you see, was already spitting mad before he even heard of the edict's promulgation, because of the contents of a very polite letter Constantine had sent him following the Battle of the Milvian Bridge. What was in this very polite letter that got him so hot? Well, first, Maximinus was informed that the Senate had gone ahead and declared Constantine the senior Augustus, a declaration Constantine hoped wouldn't cause any rupture in their friendship because I look forward to working with you, blah, blah, blah. That alone was probably enough to start a war. If there was one thing Maximinus was super sensitive about, it was his standing within the Imperial College, and here was his prestige being undermined yet again. But the letter went on and requested Maximinus's cooperation with a few changes Constantine wanted to make as to how the empire was governed. And here, probably, is where the war was really sparked. Constantine essentially sent Maximinus a rough draft of the Edict of Milan and demanded that Christians in the East be allowed to worship freely and that their confiscated property be returned to them. This, naturally, redlined Maximinus, as Constantine no doubt expected that it would. Probably around March of 313, just as Constantine and Licinius were meeting in Milan, Maximinus wrapped up his operation in the east and then raced west at full speed to prepare for war. The march is described as a brutal one, with Maximinus pushing his men and pack animals to the limit because he was determined to secure control of all of his territory before his adversaries could make their move. This meant marching them at an absurd pace. The hard drive west paid off, though, and Maximinus did indeed reach the Bosphorus before his rivals were really ready for him to be there. Not only that, but along the way Maximinus had accrued an army of about 70,000 men, enough to do battle against the strongest of armies. So they can make all the private demands they want and issue all the public edicts they want, but let's see them make me comply with any of it. Upon his arrival in Nicomedia, Maximinus recognized that he had perhaps caught his enemies flat-footed, so he took the initiative to cross the Bosphorus and lay siege to the port of Byzantium, which was garrisoned by a detachment of Licinius's army. Though the city's location made it easy to defend, something Constantine had probably already taken note of, the soldiers manning the walls were vastly outnumbered by Maximinus's army, and they surrendered after about a week and a half. Maximinus then moved on to the city of Heraclea, which also fell after a brief siege. While Maximinus was engaged in these siege operations, his adversaries were scrambling to respond. In all likelihood, both Constantine and Licinius thought that there would be plenty of time to prepare for Maximinus's return from the east. Plenty of time, anyway, to rearrange the Danube troop deployments so that Licinius could have the men he needed to fight the war, and this would be Licinius's war, without leaving some huge gaping hole in the border defenses. But that idea was premised on the notion that Maximinus was still out on the eastern edge of Syria. When Licinius received word that Maximinus was on the march, and not just on the march, but on the double-time march, it is probable that he hadn't even left Milan yet. With Maximinus barreling west, Licinius dashed back across the Alps and began at once to gather an army. But he was hamstrung by his conflicting priorities. He wanted to crush Maximinus, yes, but it would have been madness to just call up huge swaths of the border troops, which would leave the Danube undefended. By the time Maximinus crossed over the Bosphorus and besieged Byzantium then, Licinius stood at the head of an army just 30,000 strong, the best he could do on short notice. When Maximinus moved on to Heraclea, Licinius moved on to Adrianople. He was outnumbered almost 2-1, but the war he himself had just sought to provoke had come to his doorstep and there was nothing he could do about it now. In late April 313 AD, Licinius advanced southeast, and Maximinus advanced northwest, and the two armies met on the plains beside a town that I have no hope at all of pronouncing correctly, Zeralum. Beyond the fact that it is about to host a key battle of the Tetrarchy's running civil war, Zeralum is also famous for being a likely candidate as the spot where Aurelian was assassinated some 38 years earlier. And oh, by the way, has it only been 38 years since the death of Aurelian? Like the Battle of the Milvian Bridge, the battle between Licinius and Maximinus at Zeralum would be cast as a battle between paganism and monotheism. And prior to the battle, both generals allegedly made this pretty explicit. Maximinus vowed to Jupiter that if he won the battle, that he would wipe Christianity off the face of the earth for good, while Licinius distributed to his troops a prayer to the, quote, great holy God that was to be recited by his men as soon as they were lined up for battle. The prayer was supposed to have been dictated to Licinius in a dream by God, but T.D. Barnes, a noted scholar on the era whose excellent book Constantine and Eusebius has been helping me out quite a bit lately, surmises that if the story is true, then the prayer was likely written not by God, but by Constantine. Now the two emperors knew full well that they were about to fight a great battle. The only question was when said battle was going to take place. When it came to deciding this question, there was the typical jockeying for the most opportune moment on the most auspicious day, and it appears that Licinius was waiting for May the 1st to attack. Why May the 1st? Because that would be the 8th anniversary of Maximinus' elevation to the purple, and Licinius was apparently looking to duplicate Constantine's feat of taking Maxentius down on his anniversary. When Maximinus, by whatever means, heard why Licinius was stalling, he decided to attack on April the 30th, because, he said, his 8th anniversary was better suited for holding a triumph than for fighting a bloody battle. Maximinus got his way, and the Battle of Zeralum took place on April the 30th, 313 AD. Now, one of the interesting things about the war between Licinius and Maximinus is that throughout all of this, Maximinus was actually trying to avoid battle. Not because he didn't think he could win, after all, he had a 2-to-1 advantage in the manpower department, but because he wanted to win a different way. See, as much as Maximinus is painted as a villain, and given his ruthless treatment of the Christians, I think it's hard not to agree that the shoe fits, Maximinus himself thought that he was right. Thought that in a world gone mad, he was the only one left defending the old Roman way. He thought that Christianity was a genuine threat to the empire, and that it dangerously disrupted the all-important connection between Rome and her patron deities. To not eradicate the Christians, then, was criminally negligent behavior. And here were his two brother emperors, not only defending their rights, but actively promoting them. It was crazy. So what Maximinus was hoping for was that the men under Licinius' banner would come to their senses, that they would see that they were hugely outnumbered, see that they were fighting for the wrong side, and defect to his banner. Defect en masse to the only man who was still defending the honor of Jupiter, greatest and best. Constantine was not the only one playing at politics. Maximinus wanted a bloodless victory, premised on the notion that he was the good guy, not Licinius, and certainly not Constantine, who had blatantly turned their backs on all that was decent and pious in the world. Unable in the end to avoid battle, Maximinus appears, even with armor donned and sword drawn, to have stuck to this desire for defection rather than bloodshed giving him his victory. As Licinius took the initiative and attacked, rather than just sit back and be overwhelmed, Maximinus maintained an almost strictly defensive posture, hoping that Licinius' men would see that their cause was hopeless and that the great holy God was a ridiculous sham. But he was sorely disappointed. The men under Licinius' command did not give up, and they did not defect. And by waiting for something that was never going to happen, Maximinus didn't order his men to really fight back until it was too late. Licinius' army was already all over them, and pretty soon it became apparent that they were going to win this battle. That being so, Maximinus decided to at least prevent them from winning the war. He ditched his imperial robes for slave clothes and fled to the east. About half his army made good their escape, while the other half was rounded up by Licinius's men, and most of them, as is often the case in Roman civil wars, were immediately enrolled into the ranks of the army they had just been fighting moments before. The defeated Maximinus fled back to Nicomedia, but he knew he had no chance to hold the city with Licinius right on his heels, so he simply grabbed his family and a few close advisors and continued on east. Licinius, predictably, then took Nicomedia without a fight a few days later. But though things looked bad for Maximinus, he was not licked yet. As he made his way southeast across Anatolia, he gathered up the remnants of the army that had been beaten at Zeralum, and appears to have called in reinforcements from the troops stationed in Syria. Surveying the landscape, Maximinus then came to the same conclusion that so many generals before him and so many generals after him would come to, that the best place to make a stand would be at the Cilician gates. He fortified the pass and waited for Licinius's pursuing army. Licinius himself, though, would not be there in person to finish the job, having decided to remain in Nicomedia and keep a close eye on the capital. Instead, he entrusted his army to subordinates and sent them off to hunt down Maximinus. It did not take long for them to find the fugitive Augustus, and the subsequent battle at the Cilician gates, though smaller than the previous engagement at Zeralum, turned out to be the more decisive engagement. Licinius's army broke through the fortifications, and Maximinus was again forced to take flight. He made for the city of Tarsus, but this time he had no ready access to reinforcements. Trapped behind the city walls and protected by only a token garrison, Maximinus's time appeared to be at hand. Shortly after being treed by Licinius's army, word came over the wall that Maximinus Daya was dead. Whether it was suicide or some fluke disease, we will never know, but Maximinus was in his early 40s and had been first Caesar, then self-proclaimed Augustus, then full Augustus, for just over 8 years. Licinius, now the master of the Eastern Empire, remained in Nicomedia for about a month before heading off in the direction of Antioch on a tour of his new provinces. Once he got to Syria, Licinius quickly let everyone know that there was a new sheriff in town. He not only ordered the Edict of Milan strictly enforced, but also went after known persecutors with a ruthless gusto. Anti-Christians who had for the last decade wielded their sadistic power unchecked were suddenly rounded up and either exiled or executed, depending on the severity of their crimes. This purge obviously had a political purpose, as the staunchest opponents of the Christians were also the staunchest supporters of Maximinus, but it was also a visible signal to everyone that a new day was dawning. In addition to this one-part religious, one-part political purge, Licinius also engaged in a 100% political purge of any potential dynastic rivals. It goes without saying that Maximinus's memory was damned, and his family was rounded up and executed. But Licinius also tracked down the son of Severus, who had been serving with Maximinus, and had him killed as well. He also intended to dispose of Diocletian's wife and daughter, who were being held back in Nicomedia, but they managed to escape before the execution order came through. It would take 15 months of searching before the two women were finally tracked down and beheaded in a public execution. Killing women and children was not a nice thing to do, but clearly, Licinius had read his Machiavelli. Later in 313, Licinius and Constantine formalized their power-sharing agreement, with Constantine taking the west and Licinius the east, their territories divided roughly by the Adriatic. It would not take long before relations between the two men began to deteriorate. As I said last week, practically everything Constantine ever did points to him wanting from the get-go to be sole emperor. One emperor ruling one empire, serving one god. now that Maxentius and Maximinus Dia were disposed of, Licinius was no longer a helpful partner in Constantine's quest for power, but was instead an obstacle in the way. Next week, the brothers-in-law will waste no time getting on each other's nerves, and Constantine will waste no time digging up a pretext for war. But before we go this week, I want to pass along a quick birthday message to devout listener Derek, who just turned 30 yesterday. Derek, happy birthday. Now, stop listening to this podcast and go take care of your lovely wife and newborn daughter. Hello, and welcome to the History of Rome. Episode 135, Brothers in Name Only. Following the defeat and death of Maximinus Dia in the summer of 313 AD, the Roman Empire was back down to two emperors for the first time in 20 years. But unlike the previous partnership between Diocletian and Maximian, the partnership between Constantine and Licinius was not premised on cooperation and mutual respect, so much as on hostility and mutual suspicion. Their joint reign was not about working together to solve the problems of the empire. It was instead about putting themselves in the best position possible to take the other out as soon as an opportunity presented itself. The two men resembled no one so much as Octavian and Antony. They were avowed allies, legally brothers-in-law, and ready to slit each other's throats at the drop of a hat. And of course, in the end, the climax of their drama played out the same as well, with the man in the west utterly crushing the man in the east. But, just like that old drama, this new drama would take more than a decade to play out. Licinius did not have long to savor his victory over Maximinus before the responsibilities he had won for himself came knocking. After arriving in Antioch to consolidate his rule over Syria, Licinius appears to have been dragged straight away into hostilities with Rome's Persian neighbor to the east. There is very little detail in the record about what exactly was going on between the Romans and the Sassanids at this point in history, but one thing was clear. Whatever fight Maximinus Dia had been embroiled in when Constantine knocked off Maxentius, it was far from over. But though we don't know the exact circumstances, if we take historical precedents and combine them with one major contemporaneous event, historians reckon that once again the two empires were feuding over Armenia. That one major contemporaneous event occurred in the late summer or early fall of 314 AD, maybe 6 to 9 months after Licinius began campaigning in the desert. A new king of Armenia was crowned. The establishment of a new monarch over the border kingdom at this particular moment is why historians suspect Rome and Persia were fighting over Armenia. But, that said, there is nothing particularly major about Armenia getting a new king. It happened all the time. What made it a major event is that the new king Tiridates had recently been baptized a Christian, and when he took over the throne, he declared that the kingdom of Armenia would henceforth recognize Christianity as its official religion. This, of course, was the first time in history that any government recognized Christianity as its state religion, which, I think you'll agree, is a major event indeed. While Licinius was thus absorbed in the east, Constantine handled all imperial business in the west. After satisfying himself that Maximinus was dead and that he would not have to, like, invade Illyria or something, Constantine headed back north to Gaul and established a headquarters at Trier. He spent most of the next year dealing with the routine matters of government, petitions here, skirmishes with the Germans there, etc., etc. But in the summer of 314, Constantine dealt with his own major turning point in the history of Christianity. This turning point sprang from an internal disagreement within the church, which led to one side appealing to the emperor to resolve the argument. For the first 300 years of Christianity's existence, the imperial government was not just a separate institution. It was practically the exact opposite of everything Christianity stood for. But now that Constantine was in power, that was all about to change. And it is the Donatists who get the credit, or the blame, depending on your point of view, for first inviting the emperor into the church. The stage for this invitation was set by the Great Persecution. Essentially what happened is that while the persecution was going on, the Christians wound up breaking down into two camps, those who complied with the imperial authorities and those who resisted. Now that the persecution was over, the Christian leadership was faced with the question of what to do with the collaborating clergymen, who were called traditores, or men who had handed over, which gives us the root of our English word, traitor. Could they just return as if nothing had happened, or did they need to be rebaptized, or what? And more importantly, should they be allowed to return at all? You'll recall that following the Decian persecution, the church faced a similar situation, and eventually came down solidly on the side of readmittance without the need for rebaptism, and declared the opposing view heretical. You'll also recall that when we discussed what became known as the Novationist heresy, that I said it was a precursor to the much larger fight that would follow Diocletian's great persecution. Well, here we are. A faction within the church, centered in North Africa, and led by, but not founded by, the Bishop Donatus, believed that collaborating members of the clergy should not be allowed to maintain their positions, and that any sacraments they celebrated should be considered invalid. The position of these so-called Donatists was considered unnecessarily harsh by the majority of the Christian clergy, possibly because many of them could be accused of being traditores, and a far more lenient course was plotted. I don't want to dive too deeply into the minutiae of the arguments, because doctrinal disputes like this quickly turn into black holes of esoteric theology, but suffice it to say that it was a very complex issue. The two sides dug in, and the problem seemed intractable. After an anti-Donatist deacon was elected to serve as the Bishop of Carthage, under highly suspicious circumstances, it should be noted, Bishop Donatus of Numidia decided to outflank his enemies in the church and played an unprecedented trump card. He appealed directly to Constantine and asked the emperor to help settle the matter. Now, before we get too far along, I do want to point out that this was not completely uncharted territory. It is often said that the fight over the Donatist heresy and the subsequent council at Arles was the first time the church invited the emperor in to help solve their problems. But there was actually a precedent for this set during the reign of Aurelian. There was too much else going on for me to talk about it at the time, but as Queen Zenobia was extending her influence into Syria, she made common cause with a controversial bishop named Paul of Samosata, who agreed to turn his flock in her direction if she supported his claim to the bishopric of Antioch. Once Palmyra was defeated, a delegation of Christian leaders approached Aurelian and asked him to expel Paul from the city. Since their religious aims coincided with his political aims, Aurelian granted the request and Paul was exiled. That, so far as I can tell, is actually the first time an emperor got in the middle of what was, really, an internal dispute between rival Christian factions. But, that all being said, no emperor had ever gotten involved with doctrinal issues, so Constantine is definitely about to set off into uncharted territory on that front. It should be noted, though, that when Constantine accepted the petition of the Donatists, it was not because he was itching to stick his nose into church business, but because, as emperor, he felt like he had a responsibility to ensure that justice was done. Indeed, the petition delivered to the emperor had nothing to do with doctrinal disputes, but instead focused exclusively on the alleged crimes of the controversial new bishop of Carthage. The Donatist strategy was to smear their rival bishop, get the recent election results tossed out, and then get a new pro-Donatist candidate elected to the bishopric of Carthage. But despite the fact that he agreed, in the interest of justice, that the Donatists should be heard, That did not mean that Constantine was eager to jump into internal church politics with both feet. So he ordered the matter be arbitrated by the Bishop of Rome and a panel of three other impartial bishops from Gaul, who would be selected by the emperor personally to ensure a fair result. But before the trial took place, the Bishop of Rome, a staunch anti-Donatist and friend of the accused, packed the judge's table with 15 more bishops, all from Italy and all in his pocket. As soon as the proceedings began, it became clear that the whole thing was now a setup. The council not only ruled against the Donatists on the limited issue of whether the Bishop of Carthage was a guilty man, but they also ruled against them on the broader issue of their doctrinal beliefs, which the council declared heretical. The Donatists were, of course, outraged and appealed to Constantine a second time. When the emperor was filled in on the details of the trial, he agreed that the Donatists had been treated unfairly and agreed that their case should be retried. This time, before a council composed of bishops from every province in the Western Empire, a council that was to be called by Constantine himself. When the subsequent Council of Arles convened in August of 314, though, the outcome for the Donatists was the same. Their charges against the Bishop of Carthage were tossed out, and their beliefs were declared heretical. The Donatists appealed to Constantine a third time, and like most major court cases, there were a few more procedural twists and turns before the matter was finally settled for good. But in the end, the decision of the Council of Arles stood. The accused bishop was exonerated, and the Donatists were declared heretics. When the Donatists continued to pester the emperor about the issue, though, Constantine finally lost his temper. He had been at the council, though he sat as a layperson, and saw nothing untoward about the process. The Donatists had had their day in court, and they had lost. It was time to get over it, drop their complaints, and get on board with the program. Which brings us to the last two points I want to make about the whole affair. First, it gives us an initial glimpse at what Constantine's religious priorities really were. Specifically, how much weight he put in the idea of unity. As we go forward, we will see again and again that Constantine liked Christianity, supported Christianity, and believed in Christianity, but that it drove him crazy how much Christians fought with each other. Constantine didn't care what wound up orthodoxy and what wound up heresy, though there is good reason to believe he actually supported the anti-Donatist position, just as long as everyone agreed what was what. He seemed genuinely afraid that discord within the church imperiled all their souls. This fear would culminate with the Council of Nicaea, when Constantine pushed for all doctrinal disputes to be settled once and for all. This fear would also lead to the second point I want to make. Now that Donatism had been given a fair hearing and still been declared heretical, it was time for it to be purged from the system in order to maintain the all-important unity and purity of the church. So following the Council of Arles, we see Constantine nodding in approval as the first instances of Christian-on-Christian violence begin to break out in North Africa. And then, when the Donatists persisted, we see him threatening to come down there himself and show everyone how it was done. But he wouldn't get the chance, as war with Licinius interrupted his dabbling, for now, in the controversies of the church. After he left Arles in the late summer of 314, Constantine returned to Trier to keep an eye on the Rhine frontier, and Licinius returned from the east to keep an eye on the Danube frontier. At some point after the first of the year, though we really don't know when, a subtle new wrinkle in the balance of power was introduced, as Constantia gave birth to Licinius' first child, a son who we'll call Licinius the Younger. Though the baby Licinius was just that, a baby, most historians believe that Constantine immediately detected a threat to his long-term dynastic ambitions, so the Western Emperor set in motion a series of events that would eventually lead first to murder, and then to war. Though over the course of the last few years, the Tetrarchy as an institution had withered, as no replacement candidates had been elevated to replace Galerius or Maximinus Daya, At some point in 315, Constantine suddenly proposed resurrecting the idea of junior imperial colleagues. Specifically, he sent a message to Licinius suggesting a man named Bassianus be elevated to the rank of Caesar. But one additional Caesar does not a tetrarchy make, which is why scholars suppose that in addition to the documented proposal to elevate Bassianus, that Constantine further intended to elevate his son Crispus at the same time. Though we have no proof of it, the supposition makes sense on its own merits and conveniently fits with Constantine's general political posture during the period. Crispus had been born sometime between 299 and 305, while Constantine was in the east at Diocletian's court, and his story mirrors that of his father. He was the son of Constantine and a woman named Minervina, whose relationship with Constantine, like that of Constantine's own mother Helena with his father Constantius, is a bit murky. Minervina may have been an informal mistress, she may have been a legal wife who was divorced to make way for Fausta, or she may have been a legal wife who died before 307. Like Constantine himself, then, by 315 AD, Crispus stood as the son of a previous marriage who was very possibly illegitimate. But perhaps drawing from his own experience, Constantine never wavered in his recognition of Crispus, and always acknowledged and supported the boy as his rightful heir, as we are seeing right now in his attempt to make a Caesar of the boy/teenager. The presumption here is that Constantine was looking to overwhelm any claim to power the baby Licinius might put forward someday by packing a revived tetrarchy with his own people. Bassianus, you see, was not just a respected senator, he was also Constantine's brother-in-law. But Constantine didn't want to be too obvious in his dynastic maneuverings, which is why, of all his possible male relations, the Western Augustus specifically nominated Bassianus, because Bassianus' brother was a man named Senecio, who was a close friend of Licinius. Hopefully, Licinius would agree to the proposal, believing that he was getting a Caesar he could trust, and thus accept a tetrarchy essentially composed of Constantine's extended family. And if you count Licinius, who was himself Constantine's brother-in-law, then you could say that the whole tetrarchy would be composed of Constantine's extended family. But the Eastern Augustus was not buying what Constantine was selling. According to Constantine's later version of events, it was a good thing for him that Licinius shot down Bassianus' nomination, because as it turned out, the would-be Caesar was not nearly as loyal to Constantine as the Western Augustus had supposed. According to Constantine's later story, not long after refusing the proposal to renew the Tetrarchy, Licinius had actually talked his friend Senecio into talking his brother Bassianus into initiating a plot to kill Constantine, and that Bassianus had agreed to the plan. No one really believes today that Bassianus was actually involved in a conspiracy against his brother-in-law, but over the winter of 315-316, Constantine's agents allegedly caught Bassianus red-handed and the would-be assassin was executed. So, if there was no plot, why did Constantine suddenly turn on the man he had been ready to make Caesar just the year before? The answer appears to lie in the fact that after 8 years of marriage, Fausta was finally pregnant. With another heir on the way, and of course the child would be a boy, Bassianus became expendable, so Constantine used him as a convenient conduit through which to accuse Licinius of murderous treachery. After Fausta gave birth to Constantine's second son, of course it was a son, the ill-fated Constantine II, Constantine I stepped up his rhetoric and demanded that Licinius hand over Senecio so that he too could be tried for attempted regicide. But Licinius refused to hand over his old friend, and diplomatic relations between the two emperors broke down. In the fall of 316, Constantine, convenient pretext for war now in hand, led a force of about 20,000 over the Alps and into Illyria to confront Licinius. Hearing that his brother emperor was on the march, Licinius mustered 35,000 troops and marched west, ready to do some confronting of his own. The two emperors met on October the 8th, 316 AD, on an open plain near the Pannonian sitter of Cybele, and after some brief skirmishing, the two infantries got down to business. Both emperors were no doubt hoping that this would prove to be their final battle for control of the Roman Empire, but both were disappointed. After a slugfest that lasted all day, Constantine finally led a cavalry charge right before sundown that decisively routed Licinius's army. But the breakthrough came too late in the day, and darkness ended hostilities before Constantine could finish the job. Under the cover of night, Licinius gathered up what was left of his army and drove them first north to Sirmium and then east to Adrianople to regroup. It seems that it was at this point, just after the Battle of Cybele, that Licinius elevated one of his generals, a man named Aurelius Valerius Valens, to the rank of full co-Augustus. Valens had been serving as the theater commander of the Danube frontier, and it appears that with his legitimacy badly shaken by Constantine's victory, that Licinius wanted to secure the loyalty of Valens before the general defected to Constantine's side. The now co-emperors based in Adrianople then quickly raised a new army, and at some point during the winter of 316-317, the peace talks that had been ongoing since Cybele broke down and the armies of east and west met again, this time at the Thracian town of Mardia. Both emperors hoped that this would be their final battle, but alas, again, it was not. Like the Battle of Cybele, the Battle of Mardia was an extremely hard-fought affair that once again saw Constantine get the upper hand, but once again saw night fall before he could finish the job. Then, once again, Licinius and Valens gathered up their battered army and retreated under the cover of night. But they were not running scared, and their line of retreat led the so far perfect golden boy Constantine to finally make a mistake. The most obvious fallback position for Licinius's army at this point was Byzantium, and this was so obvious that Constantine just assumed that that's where his rival Augustus was headed. More than ready to end this thing, Constantine plunged east, hoping to take down Licinius before he could fully solidify his defenses. But Licinius and Valens had not, in fact, headed to Byzantium. Guessing that this is what Constantine was guessing that they'd do, they instead withdrew north into the hills. Once Constantine blew past their position, they dropped back down and neatly cut off his supply and communication lines to the west. It did not take long for Constantine to realize his mistake. Both sides stalled for time, as Licinius and Valens waited for Constantine to recognize how dire his position was, and as Constantine waited to see if his porters could somehow slip through the enemy blockade. As soon as a much-needed shipment of supplies was captured, though, Constantine threw in the towel and came to the table. On March 1, 316 AD, the two sides came together and hammered out a peace. Now, Constantine was in a tight spot, but he had still whipped Licinius twice in a row, so it's not like he was negotiating with a gun to his head. He knew that Licinius wanted this over even more than he did, which is why Constantine was able to negotiate such a favorable settlement for himself. In fact, his only real concession to Licinius was that the Eastern Augustus would not be deposed just yet. Other than that, though, Constantine dictated the terms, and Licinius accepted them. First, the Eastern Augustus would unequivocally recognize the Western Augustus as the Senior Augustus. Up until now, it had been a little unclear who outranked who. Constantine had had himself declared Maximum Augustus by the Senate, but there was no getting around the fact that Licinius had been Augustus longer, and so enjoyed a natural seniority. Now the issue was put to bed. Constantine was the top dog. Second, all the territory west of Thrace was ceded to Constantine, giving him control over Greece, which was nice, but more importantly, giving him control over all the legions stationed along the Danube. Finally, there was the small matter of Valens. Nowhere in Constantine's dynastic plans was there room for some random general inserted into the Imperial College without his approval. Valens was to be deposed and executed. Licinius agreed to everything, and Valens, who had enjoyed the novelty of calling himself Augustus for maybe 3 or 4 months, was stripped of his rank and killed. The last little bit of business to attend to was to finally address the long-term future of the imperial dynasty. Constantine had tried to restart the Tetrarchy on his own terms, and Licinius had tried to elevate a new emperor on his own terms, So now both men agreed to a simple compromise that would hopefully settle things. Crispus, Constantine II, and Licinius the Younger would all be elevated to the rank of Caesar. Now, since Crispus was at most 17 years old, and possibly as young as 11, and Constantine II and Licinius the Younger were both babies, this compromise does not represent a return to the Tetrarchy, so much as it harkens back to the old days, when a Roman emperor would give his son the title Caesar to signal that he was the official heir to the throne. Though the idea of the Tetrarchy was not entirely done for yet, as evidenced by the fact that when Licinius and Constantine next went to war, each was supported by a Caesar, clearly, the Tetrarchy is about to be relegated to the dustbin of history. The peace would hold for the next 7 years, though clearly neither emperor thought it would last forever, as evidenced by the fact that while Licinius made his capital at Nicomedia, Constantine made his at Sirmium. Both men campaigned against Rome's enemies to the north in order to justify the location of their respective headquarters, but there was no missing the obvious fact that they were basically living right next door to each other. The first time either emperor slipped up, the other was going to pounce. Next week, though, Constantine will eventually be able to stand the suspense no longer, and instead of waiting for Licinius to slip up, he will simply start poking Licinius in the eye with a stick. After enduring the prodding for a bit, Licinius will finally snap and demand that Constantine stop poking him in the eye with a stick, at which point Constantine will say, "Well, why don't you make me?" And then Licinius will say, "Okay, here I come." This time, it would be their final battle.